Hello, good night.
Hi. And Dominic will translate if needed, because I think you
generally try my best.
Need. Okay. So I thought maybe we could, let's just start with the film that you're here with, The Great Game, in case people haven't seen it. Maybe you could tell us a little bit about the film, what drew you to this part. Nicolas is a first-time feature filmmaker. Did you know him before?
Yeah, I knew him because he was a film critic in France, and we did an interview maybe 15 years ago, and I appreciated his knowledge in cinema. He's a great cinephile, and he's been working with an important French man who is involved in cinema but is not well known at all by the public. His name is Pierre Rissian. I'm sure some of you know about him. So Nicolas has been his secretary for a while, and I was a bit fascinated by his knowledge about movies and all his references. So when he came back to offer me this part in The Great Game, I saw all the references in movies that he made in his that he put in his film, from Valerio Zurlini, the right. Professor. I don't know what's right. the title in English. Yeah. To some English thrillers and some Eric Rohmer bits,
right.
because there are many very long dialogue scene in that film. Some it's a thriller, but during the course of the movie, there are some scenes where you forget about the plot, and it's just character talking about themselves, about them their feelings, about their readings. So this is pretty much like some Rohmer, at least some tale that I right. did a few years ago. So yeah, there was many elements that I loved in the film.
Right. What is it like working with a first time filmmaker? I assume it changes from person to person, but
It's always different. In that case, I think Nicolas was very well prepared. He had a good crew, especially the DP. Yeah. For me, is a very important partner on the set. The DP and I enjoy working with this DP. Then I think he's been writing the script for 5 years before we started shooting, so he knew exactly what he wanted. He has chosen very good actors, André Dussolier,
sure.
with whom I've never been working, but who is a fantastic French actor, very professional. And I felt from the start that he was very well prepared, and he wanted to act. He wanted to get into those very long scenes. It was like, sometimes like, not sport, but yes, a little bit like tennis, you know, because those dialogues are very much like dialectic?
Dialectic,
yeah. So from the first replica, I knew that he was into it. He looked at me right in the eye, and he was really listening to me. Right. Sometimes when I act, I don't think. I'm in another space. And this time, he grounded me in a way, because he really was into the words, into the meaning of what he was saying. So he kept my attention. So I think that was part of the success of the movie, in a way, that we are really talking to each other.
Yeah. I'm curious to hear you say more about this relationship between the actor and the cinematographer. What is that, you know, what is that?
Because I think
about?
He's the first audience as an actor on set. He's the one who looks into the camera, and he sees you better than anyone else on set. So it's important that he likes your work, that he's cautious about your physical appearance, but also about your acting. So after a take, when the take is over, it's the first one you look at to see if he was happy first, technically, and then if he felt something through the
lens.
Through the lens. Right. So yeah, it's like a support, very important support.
I thought maybe we could go back to the beginning of your career, which actually was, at this point now, 30-something years ago, which is a little crazy to think about.
Thank you.
So you started, you were age 9, I believe, right? When
yes.
Raúl Ruiz asked you to appear in City of Pirates.
He asked my mother, basically. But
he asked your mother if you were.
Yeah, because Raúl always says that yeah. to cast a child, you first have to cast the parents.
Right. Can you tell us how that came about? Your mother worked in cinema.
Yes, she was a PR. She all this is thanks to my mother, because I don't think I would have been an actor without my mother, without Raoul, but my inner self is not an actor, I think.
Right.
It's something that happened to me, but if it didn't happen like that by chance, I would never have the vocation to become an actor. So she was working with Raúl Ruiz. She's been a PR. She's always been working with authors. She worked with Marguerite Duras, being a PR for the movies she directed in the 70s. Then she worked with Wim Wenders and Benoît Jacquot for their first films. And she worked with Raúl Ruiz in the beginning of the 80s. And one day I went to this kind of event with my mother, and Raúl was talking. And the story that Raúl tells is that everybody fell asleep while he was talking, some crazy stories as usual, and I was the only one who stayed awake. So at the end he was talking to me and he said, "Do you want to come with me and make a movie on an island in Portugal?" And I said, "Yes." And so that's how it started. Then I met the producer, famous Paolo Branco, who gave me money, cash money by that time, which meant a lot to me because I could buy all the toys I could, and I bought a video camera with that money, so I was a rich kid. And then I ended up on that small island in Portugal, surrounded by adults. I was all by myself because my mother stayed in Paris. And it was like a dream, like a fantasy. Hopefully it was not like a nightmare, even though it could have been some kind of a nightmare, because I didn't understand what I was doing. There was no script, and I had to kill some people during the movie, you know, cut throat and do all that kind of evil stuff, which I liked, actually, as a child. It was pretty much like a game. Then the movie came out, and nobody saw that film when it came out. The only kid that saw the movie, my best friend, went to see the film and said, "It's shit." So
but
I was...
You saw it. I assume you saw it when it came
out? Yeah, I saw it. I didn't know what to think about it. Mm-hmm. I thought it would be a child movie, like a Disney pirate. The movie was called The City of Pirates.
Right.
So I would imagine like some kind of pirate movie. And it was not at all a pirate movie. I played a ghost that comes back every 10 years to kill all his family. And it's like a evil Peter Pan. Mm-hmm. And Raúl Ruiz told me that I was Pinocchio and Pinochet at the same time. So he got me into this dreamy world, which I really enjoyed. And when I get back to school, everything was boring and the kids seemed stupid. And so I bought a video camera and I started making my own films in my child room.
Right.
To connect to this world.
And you continued working with Raúl. I think you were in a few more of his films around that time in the 80s. Treasure Island, obviously.
Absolutely.
Being a key film, I think, of his. Do you remember much about that?
That was the most crazy shoot.
Yeah.
It was produced by Golam and Globus.
Yes.
Who thought that Treasure Island would be like a child movie. They were like me, basically. But when they saw the dailies, they understood that it wouldn't be like exactly the average child movie. But the movie included Martin Landau, mm-hmm, and a famous actor by that time called Vic Tayback,
right,
who was a TV actor. But there was also Jean-Pierre Léo, Anna Karina, Lou Castel, and Sheila, a French singer, pop singer. And the shoot, so we started with a lot of money, because Paolo Branco got a lot of money from Golam and Globus, but when they saw the dailies, they stopped giving money, so we ended up with no money at all. So all the scenes that should have taken place on a sailboat, we finally did it on a little wooden boat, and there was no more money to pay the hotel for the rest of the crew, and we ended up filming in the garden of the hotel.
Right.
But Raúl was very depressed because of that situation, and also because there was so many trouble. Jean-Pierre Léo tried to kill somebody on the set, and Raúl was caught at the border because he didn't have his paper. He was still a refugee from Chile by that time, so it was a very complicated shoot. And for many years, he didn't like that film. He didn't want to see that film. But right before he died, he told me,
I reconciled myself
with that movie. And I haven't seen it since then, the last news I had from that movie is because it was published on VHS in the 90s by a pedophile distributor. Yeah. I don't know why. I wonder why. Yes, there is a scene where they beat me up, so maybe that was important for this guy.
So it was around this time, you must have been what, 10, 12, or you started?
I was 13 for
13,
this one.
Okay. Yeah. And so you bought a video camera, you were shooting, what were you shooting? I know you've shown some of your, these sort of like diary style short work. That
no, actually it was like short movies, fiction. I did some, when I was like 9 or 10, I did some, I was obsessed with film noir. So it's film noir, and I play all the character, the bad guy, the good guy, and I would put the camera and say my line, improvise, hours of improvisation, then go down, then reemerge on the other side and play the good guy, and then the bad guy, and the woman, and so it was really like playing with toys, but my toy was the camera. I couldn't edit, so the movies are sometimes 2 hours long. It's quite boring, but I had a lot of fun doing that. The thing is that all my friends by that time, they didn't know about cinema. They didn't have that experience, so I couldn't play to make movies with them, so I had only myself to play with. And I did some science fiction films. I did a remake of The Fly. But the idea was that the guy didn't realize he was changing. He was in denial. And then all kind of films. And I kept on doing those films because I started in my childroom because my camera by that time was not a Camiscope. I had to be linked to my mother's VHS. Mm. So I could only film in my childroom. And since then, every time I'm shooting a movie as an actor, I bring a camera and I'm inspired by those hotel rooms. It's like getting to start all over again with that strange ambience.
Do you still have these films that you made?
Yes, they were shown for the first time in an art gallery in Paris. 6 movies from different period, and then it was published on DVD by MK2 and my friend Charles Demeau for Anna Sanders movies. Right. I think you still can find the DVD someplace. And I did another one which was longer, that was in Director's Fortnight in 2006, which was called Melvil, but it's 3 movies. And it's basically it's the same thing I keep on doing since I was 9.
Right. To come back to Ruiz, I'd love to hear you talk about your relationship with him, which spanned obviously some 30 years. You started with City of Pirates, but you were also in one of his very last films, Mysteries of Lisbon, and you had worked with him pretty consistently. And you know, starting as a child and learning about cinema and growing as a person, as an actor, and having him as a constant in your life and your career.
Yes, I must say, with Raúl Ruiz, there is some kind of a phenomenon that you wouldn't get what he was saying when you were with him, but you would only get it few years later. And it still happens since he's dead. I think people understand his movies and his ideas about cinema now that he's dead more than when he was alive. So when I was filming with him, most of the time I didn't get the part, I didn't understand the situation, I didn't understand why he would be filming like this instead of like this. I'm still an actor, you know. But now I start to realize how lucky I was to work with him and how deep his influence is still on my vision about cinema, but not only about cinema. He was more political in a aesthetic way than just a director. And for instance, the book he wrote when he was a teacher in Harvard at the beginning of the 90s are still very important for me. I read them and I understand them more and more. And it's his vision, poetical, but mostly political, finally, that matters more and more into my mind. Right. You've read his book?
Poetics of Cinema?
Yeah.
I've read excerpts of it. Yeah.
It's translated in American, and it's very important, I think, to read it, especially nowadays, because he was very visionary, especially on the narrative theory that is now so important in those TV shows and all around the world.
Right.
And he had a very interesting theory about that that ways of controlling inspiration and like the weapon.
Mm-hmm. Well, the CinemaSac in Paris is preparing this very large Ruiz retrospective, I think starting in a few weeks. And I gather that you'll be involved in discussions.
Yeah,
and
I
presenting
must as much as I can. Yeah.
I'm glad to say that we are going to be doing a smaller version of that here later this year, and hopefully we can get you back to tell more.
Sure, with pleasure.
More stories about Raoul. Before we move to onto like your more recent career, I wanted to ask you because of your mother's job, and were you exposed to a lot of other filmmakers and artists as a child? And were there any other figures who were important for you?
Yeah, I was lucky. It's a bit snobbish to say it, but my mother was among a bunch of intellectual and hard rockers too. So she was very curious about music and cinema, and it was a special era, late 70s, maybe a lot of drugs involved in it, but it seemed like a big fiesta for me as a child, with weird characters, but with very fascinating ones too. She was working with Marguerite Duras, who I knew when I was a kid, and we used to go to her country house, and she would talk to me. I would not understand what she was saying, but it was still, I could have the feeling that, and they would make movies by that time in that crazy house that she had, and she would make movies like home movies, but the friends would be Jeanne Moreau and Depardieu and Bruno Nuiten, the right, DP, yeah. But I could feel that they were having a lot of fun, and that making movies was very easy. No money involved, just inspiration and having good times, making spaghettis for all the crew. So it was this idea of, yes, having fun. And then she was friend with Jacques Lacan and all those French intellectuals. But I would prefer when she was friends with the drummer of a French hard rock band. Actually, I have a brother 4 years older than me, and he's a musician now. But when we were kids, we were more into rock and roll than psychoanalysis.
Right. So from Ruiz to, I guess, other filmmakers, what was your first non-Ruiz film? Was it with Jacques Doyon, or?
Yes, when I was 15, I did a movie with Jacques Doyon called La Fille de 15 Ans.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That was very different from my experience with Raoul, because Jacques Doyon, the script was written, you couldn't change the word, he was very, very precise,
right.
He would make like 30 takes.
And he's in that film too, right?
Yes, he's acting in that, that's maybe not the best thing he ever did, but he decided to take on the part, and it was like a professional crew, and especially this idea of making many, many takes. I didn't experience that with Raoul. Mm-hmm. Raoul, we would do many, many shots in a day, like 80 shots a day sometimes, to beat the record of Orson Welles sometimes. But with Doyon, it was the same scene over and over again, and intense scene, because the story of this movie is I'm going on holidays with my girlfriend and my father steals my girlfriend from me. I'm not sure I understood that when I did the movie, but it was painful to play. And so there was intense scene when I was crying and being in a big drama. And he said, okay, but we do it again. And I wouldn't understand why he would have me redoing it. And when I saw the movie, I understood that he took the first take. So I really didn't get it. But I was happy because at the end of the day, I was very tired and I succeeded in crying so many times. So I thought, okay, maybe that's what they call acting, or at least this kind of directors. Nowadays, Jacques Doyon is not such a big director as he was by that time. But it was hard work.
Can you tell us about Eric Rohmer? A Summer's Tale, I think, is a film that many people know, and it was actually, I think, released theatrically for the first time here not that long ago, because it had played a lot, but did not get an open.
Yeah, 2 years ago.
And it was a really huge success in, you know, for an art film, I think 2 summers ago.
Yeah, I think so.
So can you maybe tell us a little bit about what did Rohmer mean to you at the time, and what was it like working with him?
Actually, I had seen a lot of his films, and I didn't really like them, especially the guys in these movies. Uh-huh. I thought they were a bit plain, and I felt that he was more interested into girls, and the guy would be a bit stupid from my point of view. So when actually it's Ariel Dombal, one of the Rohmer muse, that told me after a Raúl Ruiz movie in which we appeared together, she said, oh, I know, I have a friend, Eric Rohmer, who is looking for a boy for his next film, but the boy needs to be a musician. And she knew I play guitar, so she thought that it would be a good match. So I met Eric Rohmer, and it was very impressive because it was in that building, Avenue Pierre Premier de Serbie. And on the buzzer, you had Jean-Luc Godard at the fifth floor, and Barbet Schroeder at the fourth floor, and Eric Rohmer at the third floor. So it was like a big Gotham City for a new wave, you know. I was very impressed. And it was his little, his now famous little bureau with all his boxes all around, his little biscuits.
His office.
His office, les biscuits, c'est biscuits.
Biscuits.
Yes, biscuits, cookies. Tea, and very artisanal kind of idea of cinema, I mean. So we had an interview. He wouldn't look me in the eye for 1 hour. He was like this. I thought he was very scared. I was a bit too, but after a while I didn't understand what he wanted from me. And sometimes he would look at me in the eye with very powerful blue iron eyes, and I would understand that I said something that he liked. So I was impressed and happy at the same time. And I played a little bit of guitar. He played a little bit of piano. He was a composer. He composed the song that we sing in Summer Tale. He was very much into music. Right. And that's how it started. Then I went to his office a few times, and he was scared that I couldn't be able to speak loud enough because the movie was shot on the beach. And he wouldn't use microphones, so I had to speak loud because he wanted his text to be honored in a way. So he went to his kitchen, he put the radio on, and he yelled, can you say the text, Melvil, from the other room? So I had to speak very loud, and I convinced him like that. Right. And then I was a bit scared at first because I didn't like his male character in his films. But then when I read the script, I thought it was so well written. It was almost like a play. Every line was linked to another line from a previous scene, and that there was a lot of undertext going on.
Sure. It's one of his best male characters, I think. It was one of the most interesting male characters.
Yeah, I thought so, because when I talked to him, I understood that a lot of what Gaspar, my character, is saying in the movie are things that Rohmer thought. Okay. In real life, right. It's really like...
Did he acknowledge that, or did you...?
He wouldn't speak like that. No. He was very shy and very... he was not like Jacques Doyon at all, you know. It was only one take, right. And no psychology. He was just trustful. When at one point when he chooses you, he would be trusting.
Right.
And it was only one take. But it was a very family-like feeling for that movie. Only 6 people in the team. Mm-hmm. All in the same house. He would do the schedule himself, push the traveling, wake up the actors. We would shoot only 2 hours a day. He knew exactly about the tide, about the sun, the weather. He had done statistics, so that day would be good for that beach. And then the other day we should do that scene. So it was he was very obsessed and very precise, very artisanal mm-hmm. way of making movies.
Jumping ahead a bit to I think what I think is another major role for you is a collaboration with a filmmaker who is more your age, more or less, is François Ozon, and in Time to Leave. You mentioned Jean Moreau earlier as somebody you knew from childhood, and obviously you have some pretty amazing scenes with her in that film.
Yeah, actually, I find out now that because I began as a child in the 80s, I had a chance to work with Michel Piccoli and Jean Moreau and even Marcello Mastroianni because it was still their era, you know. So I was, as a child, part of this era. And Jeanne Moreau was, of course, and she is still very impressive, very brilliant. And I understood that she had not a weird career, but with highlights, of course, and then low down. But she was still very curious about cinema and very strong on the set, obviously. And I was very impressed. But then she became a friend. So I was lucky to have this connection with her. And concerning François Ozon, I was impressed by his speed. Mm. He's very at ease on set. He masters all about the light and he does the framing. So he knows, he's very quick. Sometimes I thought maybe it was too quick because we would do only few takes and we would end up 2 hours before the schedule. Sometimes 1 week before it was supposed to finish the movie. But yeah, because he was framing, that's quite important to me too, like I said, for the DP. We had a very simple and direct relationship. Mm-hmm. And this movie was important for me because it's the story of this 30-year-old guy who dies. So it's all this long process towards death and towards reconciliation with himself. And the last scenes of the movie happens on the same beach as where we shot Summer Tale. Oh, yeah. He wanted that to be shot in the same location in Normandy, in Brittany, I mean. And it was a weird moment because we stayed 1 week at the end of the movie and there was no sun and he wanted the end to be sunny. Even though I die, he wanted that light and there was no sun. So we stayed 1 week without shooting and it seemed like ages for me. So I did a movie in my room, in my hotel room with my own camera about this actor about to die, but death doesn't come because the light and everything, you know. So, and I showed the movie to François Ozon and he did a good compliment. He said, it's better than my film. Maybe he was joking, but no, but that experience was intense because I had to lose a lot of weight for that film because I'm sick in the movie. So he wanted me to, I lost 10 kilos during 2 months. So I was very exhausted. It was the end of the shoot. I was about to die and everything. So at the end of the film, I felt like almost like a rebirth, you know. And because I turned 30, I thought that I've done this. Now I can become someone else. And this kind of, I was starving and... So it came up to my mind, but I mean, sometimes, and I've had the same experience with Xavier Dolan turning into a woman 10 years later. It was the same kind of cycle. Yeah. And I understood that in cinema, when you're an actor, your life is also rhythmed, or guided with some important roles that happens every 10 years.
So let's talk about that. Let's talk about Xavier Dolan and Lawrence anyways. Another, I think, I agree, very important role for you. Your first time working with him, was even younger at the time. And your first time working, I guess, in Canada. I also understand that you had a different role in the film and like you switched to the lead role not that long before the shoot.
Yeah, I was supposed to have a very small part in the movie first. Another transsexual, actually, that you still see in the movie, a woman that turned into a man. Mm-hmm. It's only one scene. But I was okay to do it because I was curious about Xavier Dolan. I haven't seen his films before, but I only saw this little man once. His energy was jumping around, and I was curious to be part of his work. Then another actor was supposed to do the main character. And maybe 10 days before the start of the shoot, Xavier called me from Montreal and said, okay, I'm sorry, it's a bit at the last minute, but would you switch from this small part to the main part? And of course, I was very happy, because when I first read the script, I was kind of jealous for the other actor to have such an incredible part and to have the chance to work with Xavier. And so I was almost ready. Mm-hmm. And I thought that it was something kind of magic because my mother directed a documentary about the same subject, cross-dressers, actually. So she's fascinated with these characters. So men who, since their childhood, likes to dress up as women and some of them just do that on the side of their normal life, and some of them go to the operation. And I edited that film that my mother directed. So I knew about the subject, I was familiar with those characters, and when I read the script, I thought it was very truthful to those people. So when he offered me the main part, I was, of course, ready to take the plane right away and get shaved and start putting on a dress. And that's what happened, because as soon as I came to Montreal, Xavier was very excited to start his film. He had everything in mind. I think if he had been a bit older, he would have played the part himself. Mm-hmm. So he would do the scenes in front of me, and basically he wanted me to copy what he was, how he was acting. So maybe that was a bit weird for the other actors, because he's so full of energy and he wants to act and he wants to be everybody. He edits the movie, he does the costumes, he does the poster, he does the PR, le dossier de presse, je sais pas comment on dit.
Press release.
Yes, the press release. I mean, he's everywhere, which I can understand, because when I was a kid, I did those films and I wouldn't understand why somebody else would come into my world and do the poster when I had everything in mind already. So I think it's a new generation thing. Mm-hmm. And I think Xavier is a bit ahead, but it's normal that some guys like this appear nowadays. Very young people that master cinema very early. Anyway, so we started filming and it was incredible experience.
You've described many different directors and many different kind of directing styles, you know, like people who are more methodical or like obsessive or more like kind of loose and different speeds. And so are you able as an actor, are you happy to just adapt to different working environments, different methods, different demands from your directors?
Yeah.
Or do you have something that you prefer?
What I prefer is to have a strong director, someone who knows exactly what he wants. And I find out with time that it's a question of language, of words. And a good director for me is the one who finds the right word to talk to the actor, but also to talk to the producer, to the technicians, also to the guy who will give money at the beginning of the project. So it's a question of words, basically. So I want the director to find the right words. And then more and more, I feel able to give ideas or to propose things, which was not the case when I was a kid, because everybody was so much older and I felt so little in the middle of this crew that I wouldn't be able to ask for another take or to propose something. And now, because I start working with directors that are sometimes even younger than I, so I think I can give more thanks to my experience in cinema. And so it's more enjoyable now. I feel less like a child in the classroom, but more like a collaborator with the directors.
Mm-hmm. I have to ask you about one more film before I open it up to the audience for questions, because we were showing it next week. It's Arnaud Desplechin's A Christmas Tale. Mm-hmm. We're doing a small retro of Arnaud's films before opening his most recent film. Can you talk a bit about that sort of fitting into this large, it was a large ensemble film, and very much a film that sort of, I think, referred to his own universe a little bit.
Arnaud Desplechin.
Yeah, and the process of, you know, sort of fitting yourself into that.
I knew Arnaud for a while. We did some tests when he directed Comment Je Me Suis Disputé. Yeah. But I guess I was too young for the part, so it didn't work at that time. But I knew about his film. I knew Pascal Cocteau, the producer. So I felt like I was already part of this crowd, you know, of this family. Then Xavier reminded me a little bit of Arnaud, like someone who could do everything on set. He could do the light, he could do the sound, he could play every part. He's very excited, and he's the first one on set and the last one to leave the set. He's like very much into it, very passionate. Many takes, and he talks a lot, even during the takes, like Xavier Dolan does. So it can be disturbing. Xavier is extreme in that sense. But since he edits himself, he has the job to take off his voice on every take, so that takes a long time. Right. Because when you're acting, you hear, no, turn right, turn left, say it like this, look at me. he says the line, then you have to repeat exactly like he said, then you have back to the camera. So because I was there every day, it was okay with me, I get used to it, but if you are on the Xavier Dolan movie only for one day, it's very disturbing to have this little man talking all the time. But he's so brilliant that you're very happy to, I mean, you. And Arnaud Desplechin is a bit the same. Like rolling on the floor, jumping and shouting, putting the music on set. And I think it's directors that have a lot of pleasure being on set. Mm-hmm. Some directors, you feel that it's more stressful and they can't wait to get into the editing room to be alone and with their image. And but like Arnaud and Xavier, they are just enjoying the moment and being among other people, having people watching what's happening, involved. So yeah, it was intense. And I'm working with Mathieu Amalric, which is one of my favorite actors in France, with whom I've been working. I mean, I did a movie when I was very young and he was an extra on that film. And I remember on set, I was 19 and he was maybe 22 or something. But you could see this little man at the back of the frame with his big eyes and his face, and I thought that who is this guy? He shouldn't be in the same frame, you know, because you could see only him being just standing, walking, and but you felt that he was going to be someone. So, and acting with Catherine Deneuve also. No, it was a great experience, and it was filmed in the family house that was very much like Arnaud, real family house. So yeah, it's. It was almost like doing a biopic of Arnaud's family.
Okay, let's open it up to the audience. I think we have somebody with mics there, so if you...
What question am I tired of hearing? Recently, I have a lot of questions about Xavier Dolan because he has become such a character. So many people are obsessed with him and fascinated. But I'm still happy to answer because I'm still fascinated with his power and his energy. I'm still okay talking about films, and I'm happy to talk about Raúl Ruiz because, as I said before, he has become more and more a lot of people are very curious about his work since he died. Even young people coming to me and they discovered one of his films on TV or and they are curious because they didn't know about him, and they discover how many movies he has made with great actors all around the world. So I feel like I'm responsible to talk about him and to be like his héritier.
His truth.
Héritier.
Oh, his inheritor.
Yeah.
Hi. What was your favorite film that you were in and why?
I really love doing that first movie, La Ville des Pirates. It stays like a great memory because I was a kid and it was fantastic. Even though when you see the movie, you ask yourself how come they had a child doing those crazy stuff. I think nowadays it wouldn't be possible to make a movie like this. But yeah, it was like an adventure, like a very special moment. Then Eric Rohmer was incredible too, because it was very sweet and very simple and very pleasant to make, no stress. Basically, the bad experience I had were linked to the stress of the director, and the stress of the director is most of the time linked to the stress of the producer, and the stress of the producer is linked to the amount of money that they have to produce the movie. So basically, the less money, the better ambience is on the set. From my point of view, unless you work with someone like Xavier Dolan, who doesn't care about anyone else but his movie, you know. So, but it's hard. That's a great. I mean, when you're a director, you have to. At one point, you have to be like a general, like a captain, or like a dictator almost. And what's important is that moment. Even though you make like 2 hours more work than it's on the schedule, you shouldn't care about the people complaining, shouldn't care about the actor who thinks that it's time to go home. It's when it's happening. And it's true that even thanks to Xavier Dolan, because he will never leave the set until he has what he wants for his editing. So now I'm a bit disappointed when I make a movie with a director who says, okay, it's, that's enough, let's do something else, and you've done only three takes, or one take. So yeah, I learned that it's the moment when you're doing that scene on that day. It's not like theater, you don't have another chance. So when you're doing that scene, you should, you'd rather make it run until it's, we're sure that we have everything. So it's not a question of experience, because Xavier was only 21 when we started filming. But he had that intuition that you have to make it happen.
Or you go back to your home or your hotel, and for the rest of your life you'll be disappointed about that moment that didn't happen.
Hi, what was it like working on By the Sea? Was it more like a Hollywood movie or a French movie?
No, I must say that since I'm in New York, 3 days, I arrived 2 days ago, I only heard very good things about that movie. And I'm very impressed and happy, because I've only heard bad things about it before I came in. And I think it's a movie that's going to take its place with time. I was happy when I was introduced to John Waters 2 days ago. And he said that two of his favorite critics, friend of his, said that it's already a cult movie and a very good movie, very interesting and special film, which I believe. I think it's a very special movie that people didn't get. And and it was the purpose of Angelina Jolie, basically, was to make a European movie, like they say. I don't really know what it means, but I understood it meant that there was no pressure because of the money, or no commercial matters involved in the process of making the film. And that was true. That's what she did. She could do whatever she wanted. She was very in charge of everything. The beauty of this shoot, from my point of view, was to see her working with her husband, Brad Pitt, who is a great actor, and the intense work they had on set. And especially his part is very interesting, I think, in the movie. He's a very loving husband, and the fact that she filmed him in that position of him loving her, whatever crazy she is and how depressed and down she feels in that movie, he's still here for her and taking care of her. And so that was a beautiful relationship to see on set. They were arguing and fighting and having a lot of exchange, but it was like a real couple making a real movie about real couple, and all this synergy of reality involved, even though they are such big stars. There was a lot of truth on that set. And I think that's when you forget about who they are and the context of the movie, you feel that. And that's what people, I think, now realize about that film, is the sense of the truth involved.
We have time for a final question, so. Yeah.
Do you have a particular dream or a vision, how you see the rest as your career continues to grow, how you love to see it evolve?
I mean, I love to work outside France more and more. I've been working in Portugal when I was a kid, but since then I did movies in England, in America, in Bulgaria, and recently I did a movie in China. I did movies in England, and that's what I like, I think, nowadays. You can't stay just doing French movies. It's more like globalization, maybe, but from my point of view, I like to travel, and I like movies to stay like adventures, like I was a kid. Not being in Paris, go back to your home and do your daily life, but it's a chance to be part of a big experience that takes maybe 3 months of your life, and you cut it with your daily life. And you travel and you work with people from different culture, different ways of making movies. The movie I did in China, I was the only foreigner on that set. And the first take we did, I didn't know it was rolling, because I didn't know how they say action or rolling. You know? So I was here with my partner, who is a famous Taiwanese actor. And he started talking to me. And I was speaking Mandarin in the movie, so that was another trouble. So I understood at one point that it was filming, you know, and it was a very interesting experience. Actually, I wrote a book about that that experience. But that's what I like about movies and being an actor. It's just like enter another world. It deals with craziness sometimes, or schizophrenia, or but it's the limit I like to improve since I'm a child, not knowing if it's true or not. And it happens quite a lot of time when you make movies with good directors.
I think that's a great note to end on. So thank you all for coming, and it was a real treat to have you here. Thank you so much.